just going to do the, I want to show you kind of how this works out when you start reading the Bible semiotically, metaphorically, and so we're going to do the death of Jesus, and here's how, I'm going to basically show you how different it is when you start reading the text as a story, not as these verses that are comprised of words. My first church was a little place up in western New York called Geneseo. It's a college town. It was a state university in New York there for Geneseo. And I went there as a pastor at 24. And it was a mission congregation. Basically, I was campus minister, and I was to start this new church. It closed a couple and put together enough people to do a church plan. So I was, young, green to the point of angry. And this is how the world has changed in my life. Immediately, because I was a pastor in that little college town, I got put on all the boards and agencies in the town. They kept calling me, "You serve on this board, you serve on this board." Now, the fact that you're a pastor keeps you off the boards and agencies. That's how things have shifted just in my lifetime. The other thing that's interesting, another huge shift. On Friday, Good Friday, the entire Main Street, Genesee on the road, shut down. I'm 12 to 3. The entire Main Street. And all seven churches in town, including the Baptist, gathered together for, can you imagine, a Good Friday service. And it always had to be at the Episcopal Church, so that really ticked me off, because why does it always have to be at the Episcopal Church? But it was right downtown, almost on the center of the village, the square. But we all gathered from 12 to 3 for a Good Friday service, and that's why the merch was shut down, so everybody could go together as a community. And during that 12 to 3 period, we participated in a Good Friday ritual, and some of you know what it is. It's called what? You don't do this, in fact, seven last words of the cross. Since I'm the low one on the totem pole, I do get the pick usually. I was the last one. So I got to preach on what everybody else didn't want. And of course, it was either one or two. Mother, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. What do you do with that? Or, today would be a new parent. Those were the kind of the last words that nobody wanted. So I was there for 7 years, and so I ended up, and I left there to go to this seminary in Ohio. But I had to deal with these two words. Now, the one that I wanted, always wanted, I felt like I knew most of it, was what? Can you imagine which one said it? My God. Why hast thou forsaken me? That's the one that I really wanted. I think maybe the last year I was there, I got it. What I'm going to do this morning, and this is what a semiotic reading of the story of the cross will do to you, is I want for the rest of your life, whenever you hear any reference to those seven last words, I want it to do to you what fingernails do to a blood. Because we have turned three of the greatest stories of Jesus' life, three of the greatest moments we already know that these seven last words aren't words, because each one is a phrase, even though we call them words. But I want to argue that if you do your semiotics right, and you read the Bible, the way in which it was meant to be written, and meant to be read, the way it was written, and you start connecting dots, and you start trusting the story, those seven words will disappear, and what will pop out are three stories. Now let's start with, I gotta watch my time here. But, let's start with Mother, behold your son. Son, behold your mother. A part of the key to reading the Bible semiotically like this is you've got to image the story. I mean, it's a turn it into a movie in your mind. You've got to see it. You've got to see it. So, part of seeing what's behind this exchange is to see the characters that are involved. These aren't just words. These are people. This is a whole narrative. So who do we have? Who's a part of this? What's the back story of these? Mother, behold thy son. Son, John, behold your mother. Okay. The disciple whom Jesus loved is there, along with who else? Three Marys. You have three Marys and John. Who have stayed with Jesus. Now, wait a minute, you got a picture of this. And stayed with him enough that he can talk to them. Which means they've got to be what? Pretty close. How? Why is that huge? The very fact that Jesus can talk to them, if they're close enough for him to talk to, is huge. There's a couple things behind it. First of all, we know now that we have portrayals of Jesus being crucified way high and lifted up. We now know that people who crucified were much closer to the ground. We also know from something that people stood back from crucifixions. They didn't get anywhere near people being crucified. Why? You gotta remember that crucifixion is the Roman science of torture. If you saw the Passion of Christ, you saw the largest, biggest grossing, money-making R-rated movie in history. It's an R-rated movie that made more money than any other R-rated movie. And it was R-rated because of the violence. They had a tone in there. You have no idea. A crucifixion was, everybody who was crucified naked. With all body parts and functions exposed. And that was part of the crucifixion. See, they tried to crucify you socially, psychologically, and physically, but serially, as your body parts shut down organ by organ. And part of the crucifixion, socially, psychologically, was to humiliate. Part of the humiliation is the way in which you lost control, and the account of the smells. You're going to get near because the smell of the combination of the vomit and the urine and the feces and the blood and the sweat all come together. Plus, there's all this spray that's coming out of there. So nobody got close. And you couldn't get close because of the smell and because of the spray. And here we have three Marys and John. Willing to get close to them. Willing to risk it. All of the spray and snow for the sake of Jesus. Now, what does that tell you about the other disciples? The only ones there. Where are the rest of them? They're hiding. But understand, it's not just Judas who betrayed Jesus. It's not just Peter who betrayed Jesus. When Jesus needs his disciples most, there's only John. So, you see what I'm trying to do? I'm trying to put this in a narrative form. And I want you to get the whole story of what's going on. And here's the problem. You got to do this. We don't have commentaries basically can help you do this. Because everybody's so fixated on these words and parsing the words. You're going to have to. We got to do this. What it means to read the Bible in American culture today is we got to go to Bible dictionaries, encyclopedias, and start looking this stuff up. This is the moment also that Jesus is on the cross dying for the sins of the world. This is the moment when Jesus ministry is most cosmic, most universal. You with me? He's dying for God so loved the world. Actually, the word is cosmos. This is when Jesus is being his most universal. And at that very moment, he's also the most particular. I want you to hear this. The way to the universal is through the particular. A lot of us want to go straight to universal, we want to go straight global. No, you don't get the global until you do the local. You don't get the universal until you get the particular. It's about time the local church discovered the local. We don't know. Local churches, last thing I heard is local. Or if they're local, they're in Rick Warren's local. Or they're in Willow Creek's local. They're not doing their local. When Jesus is most universal is when he's most particular. And he's got a pastoral issue here. The pastoral issue is what? What to do with his mother? Is it that just there? Okay. Any more? Well, why would he be considered worth of return? Okay. This is called the discipline of historical context. Can you all say that? When you are reading a story, you've got to discipline yourself to put that story in its historical context. 30 today. Anybody here 30? He's young. But we have no idea how fast things have moved. In the 1890s, the average life expectancy for a male was 37. I'll repeat this. In 1890, the average life expectancy for a male at birth was 37. In 1990, the average life expectancy for a male was 74. Today, it's already 78. So, it's going up, up, up. This is huge. Fast growing segment of the American population percentage-wise are centenarians. In fact, there are so many people now, over 100, that in these homes, they have a big debate. They have a new category called super centenarians. And the super centenarians start at 105 or 110. This is the big debate in some of our residential villages. when do superseminaries start? There's so many of them. So we have this notion that 30, Jesus is, as one song puts it, this young and fearless prophet. You gotta put the story in, what's the phrase? You gotta discipline yourself to put it in this historical context. You can Google very quickly and find out what's the average, what was the average life expectancy for a male in the first century at birth? 26. Now, if you lived to 5, and because the infant mortality was huge, then you had a life expectancy of, there's lots of debates. But you got into your 30s, some say as much as early 40s for some. But you see, there's a whole, when do you become a full-fledged adult? Century in Jesus' day. Hey, I'm pretty sure I know when Joseph died. I mean, Joseph died before Jesus was 14, because every good Jewish male, by the age of your firstborn male, if you had a son, and we know something about Joseph, he was a good Jewish male. By the age of 14, you had already done something for your firstborn son. Now, what had you done for that son? Arranged his marriage. And Jesus is lifeless and childless. And we have no idea how strange that is in the first century. Jesus is lifeless and childless. So, I think that Joseph, I think it's a big sign that Joseph died before Jesus. If we know Joseph's alive and Jesus in the temple, telling his parents, I'm about my father's business. Now, they didn't have bar mitzvahs back then, but that's the equivalent. Jesus is saying, I'm about my father's business. By the way, they're not telling us that 26 for men is the 18. I've got a 22-year-old. Can you turn this off? My 22-year-old is the best 17-year-old will ever be. I look at what I've for for 30 years. Really? Maybe something in the Bible for retirees. You have a word in the Bible for retire? Die. Until age 83. It plateaus at 83 and starts to go down a little after that. But you continue to be creative and to grow in your creativity until 83. And you spent 30 years in college. First age in the first century, 0 to 12. Jesus. At 30, it's time now for him to save the world. I can question what 30 might not be bad to be. What are you doing to save the world? You got 30 years to join Jesus. This is when you make the biggest impact. This is when you make the biggest difference. And we turn it into this is when you go to a rocking chair. This is when you've got the time, the freedom, the energy, the creativity to do your greatest, make your greatest contribution. These are the best years of your life. And the question is, so Jesus, as he enters his third age, it's time to save the world. So the first thing he does, he's got 3 years in which to do it. And he says, okay, here's how I'm going to save the world. I'm going to write me a book. Okay, he says, I'm going to start a new megachurch. He says, okay, I'm going to start a new religion. He says, what? I'm going to gather some disciples. I'm going to get me a team. And go walk. Exactly. And that's huge. We don't have time to do this, but there's just a new book out, Cambridge University Press just published it, called Walking in Enrollment. And what is the United States Christian wrong? Well, what he said is that everybody had a distinctive walk, and your walk was as distinctive to you as he put it, as your nose was to your family. And the first thing that philosophers would do would be to give their followers a unique walk. So I'm working now on this book called The Christian Walk. Jesus gave his disciples a unique walk. A way of walking in the world that other people could identify. Now, let's back up. Okay, now I want you to put yourself in Jesus' place. You have spent 18 years, the majority of your life now, your adult life, in this little place called Nazareth. How big is Nazareth? We're talking about a couple hundred families at most, or no more than 300-400 people. Mostly some of them are related, you know, in some way. I don't know about you, but if I'm going to start my ministry and I'm going to put together a team, who am I taking with me on my team?
is eaten.
Jesus takes nobody with him from his own town and puts him on his team. Zero. Water. Come on, get up the guys. Water. And how do we know that? When he went back to his hometown, what did they want to do? Well, let's put it in the language of the first couple. They want to do an honor scale. Throw him off a cliff is capital punishment. That's the Jewish form of capital punishment. Right? That's the whole thing about it's called stoning. They stone in two ways, put you in a pit, things up, and throw you off a cliff. That's called stoning. His own family wanted to do a honor scale because you have embarrassed the family because you're claiming to be. Unless you're willing to. The only place he could do the miracle was. So you see, there's a huge rupture. Nobody from Jesus' first 30 years or in his family are a part of his new family. He's got these feuding factions of his family and his half-biological family, if you will, and his new family, his disciples. And he can't save the world and repair those ruptured relationships until he does what? Heals that broken relationship between his home birth family and his new family. And at the moment of his being his most universal and saving the world, he is also tending to this one loose thread. He's got feuding family and disciples, and he's got to bring them together. And at this moment, when he's dying for you and for me, he's also bringing together his family, old family, and his new family. And he says, Mary, your son. Son? John? Suddenly, guess what? Well, who becomes the head of the Jerusalem church? We even got a book in the Bible by Jesus' brother called James. And that broken relationship is healed in that moment. The tradition is in that moment. Studying Carl Barth Seminary, but my son Justin was taking one of his master's degrees. One is in biomedical sciences, and the other is in theology. How in the world are they able to work together? But when he was studying at Drew, and he took a course on Barth, so I never read Barth, so I decided I didn't need to read some Barth to talk to him. And but I'm not going to do the dogmatics thing. So that's the third part. And it was called Deliverance to the Captives. And I liked it too, because it says these were sermons that Bart delivered to a prison. And immediately I'm interested, because some of the greatest literature in Christian history has been prison literature. Maybe some. Give me a book. Give me a book. Philippians. Another book of Bible, prison literature. It was written from the Dachau of the first century. Revelation. Where John wrote it on the Isle of. And then you go through Christian history. I mean, John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress. I mean, you go back up to Bonhoeffer's letters and papers from prison. Martin Luther King Jr.'s letters from Birmingham jail. I mean, so I love prison literature. So I get the book, and it's this little tiny thing, and even the backstory is even more interesting. Bart had a best friend who was a prison chaplain. He lived in Switzerland. And his friend would periodically on vacation say, "Bart, you cover for me." And so everybody knew that Bart was doing this, but what they didn't know, and everybody assumed that Bart was just going in and preaching old sermons. When Bart died, he opened up a drawer, and there was a collection of all his prison sermons, and they were all specifically written for those prisoners. Now, immediately, my estimation of Bart goes way up. You see, it's so Jesus to bring the best to the least. So Bart's bringing his best stuff to the least. They took some of them, they take all of them, they translated into English. And it comes out Deliverance to the Captives. So I kind of open up the book, and I'm getting excited. I figured I'd start reading. That's the way I usually start. Even the back door reader, I'm a sort of a reader, random reader. And I put my finger down, and Bart was right in the middle of a rant. And it's kind of interesting, because I can't figure out what he's ranting about. He's foaming and fuming about any reference to Jesus on the cross by himself. And he's going on about Christian artists don't get it. And it's so bad to portray any story of crucifixion with a single cross. Now, he says you can portray an empty cross and only one. But if you're going to portray Jesus on the cross, you got to tell the whole story. Because Jesus didn't die on the cross by himself. He died flanked by two criminals. That's the story of Good Friday, Bart says. So tell it like it was. Don't tell it just with Jesus on the cross. Tell it like it was. See, trust the story. Let's get the story right. If the story has three crosses in it, you know what that means? God wanted three crosses to be there for a reason. In other words, three crosses are important to the story of Good Friday. Now, what's the importance then of those three crosses? So Bart, now, and the two other people that were part of Good Friday are two. All right? They're criminals. Now, who's Bart's population? They're prisoners. So this immediately brings them into the story. You don't have Good Friday without you in the picture. They never bring them. And he would have done that if he had written those words. That was just for them. In other words, Bart, in contextualizing and going local with his sermon, uncovered this incredible insight. I don't think I ever would have come up with it unless I read the part. And so Bart, push through the book. But Bart starts, he keeps going on and goes, in fact, this is the story of Good Friday. You have three criminals in the eyes of the culture, and three criminals on the cross, not just two. There's three. He says, one good, two bad, one who became good. That's the story of Good Friday. Three criminals on the cross, one good, two bad, one who became good. That's the story of Good Friday. Three criminals, one good, two bad, one who became good. And Bart goes up. In fact, you might even call this the first Christian community. First Christian community is comprised of three criminals. One good, two bad, one good. Then Mark goes a little further than I went here, but we go
close.
In fact, you may know this is the first church. See, Jesus said, two or three gathered together. So this is the first church. First Christian church. It's comprised of three criminals. One good, two bad, one became good. So you call yourself a church? Show me your bad. You just got a church full of good people? Oh, so you're better than Jesus. Oh, Jesus' church. I'm leaving my mark. This is my favorite definition of the gospel. Jesus ate good food with bad people. Jesus met his ministry with good people. Jesus calls us out to walk the world and meet all the, and spend your time with all the good people. Steve's just been serving the people that nobody else wants. Everybody else, not good people, but bad. In fact, Steve, part of their church campus, they have a smoking section. This is a Southern Baptist church, a smoking section. Because Steve says, listen, if I didn't have a smoking section, I'm just glad this is all my people smoking. This is a step up. Jesus, in fact, one of these two, Jesus says to him, today you will be with me. But we're leaving Margaret on that. But do you notice Jesus only got 50%? Even Jesus only got 50%. You know the story of Alexis? The rabbis estimated what percentage of the Jewish people actually left Egypt, which preferred to stay in bondage, and they figure it's about 50-50. You thought the whole Jewish population left? That's Cecil D. Mill. Even Jesus only got 50%. His dying moments. But we live and die together, and you don't give up on anybody to the very end. You stay with them to the very end. We live and we die. Jesus only got 50%. How much better do you think you can do? Not everybody will say yes. But we never give up on anybody. And we stay in relationship with them. Now, I can leave it there. Or we can take it, well, can you trust the story of the woman? It's important that you trust these things. It's important. These little details are important. We even know what kind of criminals they were. What kind of criminals were they? trust this in me. On either side of Jesus, we're just two criminals, but we know they were two criminals who were he. And just as maybe just as the world saw them, not just as two criminals, but three criminals, maybe, maybe the story of Good Friday is the story of three thieves. And maybe the real story of Good Friday is the story of that third thief. You see, there's different kinds of robbery. You can rob objects and possessions, which is what those other two thieves were guilty of. But there's other kinds of robbery. There's other kinds of thievery. And maybe the story of Good Friday is the story of that third thief who stole from the woman with five husbands her shame and her guilt. Who stole from that centurion his doubt and his despair. Who stole from that leper his ostracizement and isolation. And the whole story of the Gospels is Jesus steals everything that is keeping people from being who God made them to be. Maybe the story of Good Friday is that third thief. In fact, the greatest heist in history is when that third thief stole from Satan his power over you and me, and stole from the grave its sting and victory. Well, maybe the story of Good Friday is about that third thief who came to steal your heart and mine. That third thief. Have you given him license to steal? Those things keeping you from being what God made you to be and calling you what God's calling you. That's the real story. That third thief of God. Now we got 10 minutes and we got 5 more words. I told you there were 3 stories. So we got it. How can 5 words mean one story? See, we really basically, we don't trust Jesus to do what he says he's going to do. So we are drawing boards. Or we hire consultants to come who have experts at drawing up this program, drawing up this strategy, drawing up this, drawing up that, draftsmen, architects, draw for us a strategy so that we can attract. Now, your job and mine is simply to what? Lift him up. And who's the draw? He's the draw. So how do we lift him up in a culture that thinks, narrows, communicates, So, right now, I want you to close your eyes. I want you to lift him up in your mind's imagination and give me an image of Jesus praying. Can you open that? Just from your exposure to Christian arts, literature, give me an image of Jesus at prayer. I bet you can. Okay, let's move. Lift him up in your mind's imagination and give me an image of Jesus preaching and teaching. Okay, I bet you can. Let's try another. Give me an image of Jesus healing. Okay, let me try. There's something that we do more in worship than anything else. And so let's certainly got to make sure this one. So here's another. Give me an image of Jesus singing. Okay, open your eyes. Isn't that interesting? That the thing that we do almost more than anything else is worship. We have no image of Jesus. Do you know there's no? Nobody in Christian history has painted a portrait of Jesus, an image of Jesus. I mean, there's a bearded guy, but it's kind of a life of Ryan thing, you know. But, so Jesus didn't sin. Okay, we know. The Bible does say he sinned. He's saying, it actually says, but you know, nobody's ever portrayed Jesus as the Last Supper singing with his disciples. Isn't that interesting? Now, what did he say? Amen. Musicians, go. Which one? Which ones? So now we don't know, well, how many of them he sang, how many times did he have sung, but he sang. But hello, sung. So have you ever read Psalm 114, 118, realize that this is what Jesus sang to his disciples, that's what he saw? Ever sung as Jesus might have sung with his disciples before he went out? We don't know. But we know he sang. How awesome. Now, we also know that Jesus, as a Jew, would have. You see, the Psalms are. What kind of literature is the Psalm? It's a song book. Okay. And a good Jew would never recite the Psalms. You always sang the Psalms. You always chanted the Psalms. Okay, so even if you started to quote a Psalm, you would. It's so wonderful to know that Jesus on the cross had this God-forsaken moment, because we can identify with that. But it has always bothered me a little bit that why did Jesus have two God-forsaken moments? Because what went on the night before? Yeah, he went through such anguish and turmoil of spirit that he did what? He sweat blood. Now tell me the story of sweating blood. What does that mean? It's a name, and I cannot say it right, but it's hematidriosis or something like that. It's a natural condition. By the way, it is the worst response your body can come up with. And it actually, when it happens, most people die from it. Because what it is your body's anticipating what's going to happen to you. And as your body's going through this, it's actually going through what's going to happen. And so you literally, your body starts to sweat, the membranes break down. And if you do live from this sweating of blood, you basically, your whole body is raw now. It has no skin left because it's all been shed. So your whole body is as raw. You can't even come near somebody that's been through this with a feather. Get near them without the pain being unbearable. It is the worst response, the most severe response the body can have. And so Jesus went through it. Let this cup pass for me, but not my will. So why does he have it again? Well, he doesn't have it again. He doesn't have it. By the way, those are not Jesus' words, they are what? A song. Our recitus is such that we don't even understand that Jesus here singing the greatest artist on this new world. The greatest artist on this new world, we missed it. And he sings the greatest artist on this new world from the cross. He would not have said this. These are not his words. These are Psalm 22. These are the opening words of Psalm 22, which is, in the biblical, the narrator's way of saying it, right? That he sang. Now, okay, you say, well, we don't know how much of the song he sang. Well, I'm 99.99% sure he sang the whole song. Because if you look carefully, and you've read it, if you haven't even read Psalm 22, it's the song that Jesus sang from the cross. I'm going to say it for you. Somebody wants to come up and do that. I want to read it for you. Because even if he just, let's take the worst case scenario, even if he just sang the first line, listen, if I do my hope is built on nothing less than, but if I stop there, you're still hearing this whole song. I've essentially, functionally, summed up the whole song for you and invited you to continue to sing. So, even if he just sang the line, you want to be a literalist about this and say, well, he just sang the first line, he still sang the whole song. But we have so not. We've been so focused and fixated on these verses, we've missed the greatest song ever sung in the world. There would be Psalm 22. I don't know what translation this is. What is this? Here is the song Jesus sang on the cross, the greatest song ever sung in the world. I want you to listen to it. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me, from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer. By night, but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted. They trusted, and you delivered them. To you they cried, and were slain. In you they trusted, and were not put to shame. But I am a worm, and not human, scorned by others, despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. They shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue one of the likes. By the way, does this sound familiar? Remember the story? What's going on? This is the story. Remember when they said to him, call up your 10,000 angels. But the Lord delivered you. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. I knew I was cast from birth. And since my mother bore me, you have been my God. I just see Jesus as he's singing this, looking at Mary. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near. There is no one to help me. Many bulls encircle me, strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like a ravening or a lion. I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. Actually, it's turned to wax. Remember what's happening to his heart? It is melted within my breast. My mouth is dried up like a pot shirt. My tongue sticks to the root to my jaws. In other words, what? You lay me in the dust of death, for dogs are all around me, a company of evildoers encircles me, my hands and my feet are shriveled. That is so bad. Who translated this? Yeah, meaning uncertain. Are pierced, meaning uncertain. Some of the other translations will have pierced. My hands and feet have pierced. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. Do you see what's going on? Jesus is in song form describing what? His very crucifixion. The Bible says over and over again, and Jesus went ahead of him. Anyone ahead of him? He's always going ahead of his disciples. He's always ahead of us. And here, even in his death, he's ahead of us. He's describing in singing. O Lord, do not be far away. O my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion. Now, what about these dogs that keep appearing? Why have the dogs show up? We only have one, in all of Romans, crucified, tens of thousands of people. We only have one remains of Abraham crucified. Why is there so few remains of Abraham crucified? Yeah, because part of the crucifixion, they would leave on the cross, and the vultures would come and pick your body parts, and that would fall to the ground. The feral bodies would consume. From the horns of the wild oxen, you have rescued me. I will tell of your name. into my brothers and sisters in the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You will fear the Lord, praise him, like the offspring of Jacob, glorify him, stand on him, like the offspring of Israel. For God did not despise or abhor the affliction of the afflicted, God did not hide his face from me, but heard when I cried to him. From you comes my praise to the great congregation. My vows I will beg for those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Here's the Magnificat. I heard the little lullaby Mary sang to him. Those who seek the Lord shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. And all the families of the nations shall worship the earth before him, for dominion belongs to the Lord. He rules over the nations. To him indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust. Now what's happening the next day? Where does Jesus go? Down to the dust. And I shall live for him. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that he has done it. By the way, no translation, he has done it. Is it? It is finished. It's not a God-forsaken cry. It's a victory cry. And by the way, he dies at what time? 3 p.m. His last words are, it is finished. What's going on in the temple? The last Paschal lamb is being slain. And the words of the high priest as the last Paschal lamb is being slain are, trust the Lord. It is finished. The greatest story ever told. And the greatest song ever sung. We missed the greatest song. The Greek word we translate as good news, evangelion. But there's a story, always a story. What's the story behind evangelion? Evangelion, before the Christians used it, it's only used once. And it was this. You had a. When your village is at war, at this time, Philip, just a little sort of context. Your future depended on whether your side got lost, your future village was totally dependent. This is called spoils of war. You with me? Spoils of war meant the victor belonged to spoils. And the men were off at battle, women and children or old people were at that village, and if you won, you were safe. If you lost, what? Women, what was your future? Rape. Slavery. Children, what was your future? Slavery. Old people, what was your future? Death. So your whole future depended on whether your side won or lost. And you had people that you put to the very edge of your village that would wait for the runner. It was called runner. Because they didn't have newspapers and email. I mean, they had runners. And the runner would come to deliver whether you had won or lost. And so you waited to hear the words of whether your side won or lost. And if you lost, you heard the words, you lost. And then you ran for the hills. Well, most of the time they ran about you. But the word that you were yearning for, the word that you wanted to hear, and the runner would scream it at the top of his lungs, and many times his feet were bloody from running for days to give you his word. Blessed are the feet of those who. Word that you want to hear, the best word in a man, you're saying, was the word evangelion. It was the victory cry of the runner who would yell, this greatest song ever sung in the history of the world is when the runner from heaven to earth with bloody feet and bloody hands. You're saved. A victory song. The three greatest stories. Not seven lessons. Okay. Thank you all.